Bill Wilson was desperate. This was the 1930s. He was not in denial. He knew exactly what was wrong. He knew it was killing him. He knew that if he didn't stop it, it would ultimately stop him. He desperately wanted to stop and could not. And he was baffled. And he said to Dr. Silkworth, "I've tried everything you've suggested. You know that I've been sincere in my attempts, and here I am in the hospital again." And then these words popped out of his mouth. And you know that in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, Bill Wilson characterized alcoholics as self-will run riot. Listen to this question that came out of the mouth of one who is so self-willed. "I wonder if I can't get sober by trying to help another person get sober." Self-preservation is the first law of nature. Bill Wilson simply wanted to continue to breathe. He had tried everything, and he knew it wasn't working, and in complete desperation he said, "I wonder if self-fulfillment and achievement and happiness, sobriety, I wonder if it isn't available by commitment to other people." Over 20 million Americans are in long-term recovery. We value our anonymity. But there comes a point where we feel compelled by conscience to speak on behalf of the poor who are attempting to recover from addictions. We are a voice of the addiction recovery community who feel a moral obligation to formulate a response to Montgomery County Alcohol and Drug Task Force policies that discriminate against people in or seeking recovery. Our goal is simple: to support abstinence-based recovery community organizations and their communities in developing and sustaining a constituency of consequence, an organized voice of people in recovery who are educated on key issues, vote on election day, and hold elected officials accountable long after the polls close. In a 2010 national survey by the Department of Health and Human Services found that over 22 million Americans suffer from alcohol or drug dependency. Drug overdose rates have more than tripled since 1999, claiming a life every 14 minutes. In fact, it's hard to imagine a single person in the whole country who hasn't been directly or indirectly affected. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the abuse of painkillers was responsible for close to 500,000 emergency room visits in 2009, a number that has nearly doubled in just 5 years. Joe Zook, retired executive director of the Adamus Board for Montgomery County, estimated that 125,800 people in Montgomery County, 23% of the county's population, need services from across the alcohol and drug and mental health continuum. He warned of the low availability of treatment services in our community and the significant barriers that exist for individuals seeking treatment. To its credit, starting in 2014, the new National Health Plan will mandate insurers for the first time ever to treat addicts the way they treat victims of other diseases, putting an end to decades in which desperately ill addicts have been denied life and death treatment. For their part, however, Republicans have been more restrained on the subject. During the season's endless series of GOP debates, not a single candidate was quizzed about their policies on alcohol and drug treatment. While Ron Paul has been an articulate advocate of drug legalization, Mitt Romney and Rick Santorum's websites devote not a word to their drug policies, even though Bain Capital, once run by Mitt Romney, is one of the leading owners of the nation's 20,000 rehabs and sober living facilities. Newt Gingrich, a one-time pot smoker who's lately taken to extolling the virtues of AA's Big Book, has maintained a hardline anti-drug stance, even though he's backed down on his former pledge to put drug dealers to death. Given the expensive impact of drugs and alcohol on our medical and prison system, and addiction's massive impact on workforce productivity and families. The continued lack of serious discourse on the issues remains surprising. People living abstinence-based recovery, our families, church congregations, medical professionals, educators, employers, and friends, believe it's time for a common sense discussion of addiction treatment from our perspective. In 2008, an estimated 42,390 Montgomery County residents aged 12 and older needed services for addictions. The county's Gateway Assessment Service, Crisis Care, reported that only 5,106 citizens, or 12% of individuals with addictions, received assessment services in the public health care system that year. Only 7% of those assessed as needing treatment made it to their first treatment appointment, and only 2% of those who made it to their first appointment completed all their treatment sessions. In 2004, the Great Lakes regional average dropout rates between the first call for an appointment at an addiction treatment agency and the first treatment session ranged from 50 to 64%. The discharge status data for those who entered and successfully completed a publicly funded addiction treatment program was 41%. Montgomery County assessment and treatment outcomes reflect a dysfunctional recovery healthcare system that's about to get worse. The County Task Force report acknowledges that while others receive treatment services through the private system, those can't be calculated due to a lack of data integration between the public and private systems. However, they fail to note in the same sentence that only 3% of adults receiving alcohol and drug residential treatment have private insurance or Medicaid to pay for treatment services. The costs to society are measurable. 50% of all arrests in Montgomery County and its above average recidivism rate are drug and alcohol related. In 2007, unintentional drug overdoses surpassed motor vehicle accidents as the leading cause of accidental death in Ohio. And Montgomery County has the highest overdose rate in Ohio. 23% of all non-traumatic deaths in our county occur from drug overdoses. The majority of overdoses are from a combination of methadone and Xanax. These are epidemic proportions. Total Ohio state funding to treat addiction has declined 56% from $31.4 million in 2004 to $13.8 million in 2008. That was a loss of more than $17.6 million. The outbreak of the 2008 financial collapse would result in further state budget cuts for treatment of addictions without serious consideration of the cost-benefit to society. The cost reductions will ultimately be passed with multiplier effect onto local businesses, prisons, hospitals, and taxpayers. Montgomery County property owners bear primary responsibility for funding the human needs of our poor citizens. A county human services levy is financed with a property tax that generates about $91 million a year, depending on collections. In 2010, the county spent about $135 million annually on human services. Federal and state matching funds make up the difference. The Montgomery County Alcohol and Drug Task Force was established in 2008 to address our local health care crisis. Individuals impacted by addictions can be found in every neighborhood of every community of Montgomery County. Alcohol and drug addiction does not discriminate against any race, gender, or socioeconomic background. The task force was guided by five key principles, focusing on infrastructure, prevention, treatment, service linkages, and data sharing. Its stated goals are to increase capacity and consolidate systems. The consolidation process resulted in 32 task force recommendations. The report had much good information about the need for treatment, halfway house placement, and ongoing support for 12-step recovery. However, some of the policy implementation recommendations don't reflect the report's findings. And addiction treatment providers and people living recovery had very little representation on the task force. We appreciate Montgomery County Task Force's effort to address the addiction issues, but we believe that there's a critical piece missing in the policy implementation recommendations. The report clearly indicates intention to shift funding away from alcohol and drug residential treatment to detox services provided by methadone clinics. The task force recommendation for detox only address methadone. At this time, opiate addicts are being encouraged to get on methadone despite the fact that many want abstinence. What about the opiate addict who doesn't want methadone? What about the late-stage alcoholic who needs detox? People for Recovery are advocating for an abstinence-based treatment option available to all addicts and alcoholics in need with assertive linkage to recovery communities. A Bridging the Gap recommendation states that funds currently allotted to alcohol and drug residential treatment should be diverted for use by case management. The plan is to shift 95% of all alcoholics and addicts to 12 to 18 month outpatient case management services if additional funding can be secured. This shift in funding priorities should not come at the expense of late-stage alcoholics and addicts who are in need of residential detox and treatment services. We must emphasize that models of sustained support are an extension of the acute care model, not a call to eliminate resources for acute stabilization and recovery initiation. Further, case management has a tendency to shift the focus of recovery from the person seeking treatment to the case manager. Long-term outpatient case management should not attempt to replicate, replace, nor operate in isolation from local recovery communities. Such an effort is viewed as counterintuitive and a waste of taxpayer dollars. A Bridging the Gap recommendation states that funds currently allotted to alcohol and drug residential treatment should be diverted for use by mental health services. The trend is to make all treatment centers into dual diagnosed programs. While this is fine on the surface, a huge majority of the chemical dependency population is not in need of mental health counseling, but have the need and desire for sobriety and an abstinence-based life. Better living through modern chemistry may be good economic development policy for the pharmaceutical and medical industries, but mood-altering chemical methods of treatment are not right for everyone. In fact, what appears to be a co-occurring mental health disorder often disappears in time with sustained abstinence. In any discussion of social justice, there must necessarily be a discussion of community responsibilities. We wish to point out that words are important when asking the American people to assume some of the responsibilities for care of poor citizens who are in bondage, destitute, and dying from addictions. We view the inclusion of the language of abuse, or by implication, abuser, used in the task force title and throughout the report as a misapplication of a morality-based language that inaccurately portrays the role of personal volition when depicting a medical condition. If you want to care for something, you call it a flower. If you want to kill something, you call it a weed. The task force organized a series of focus groups to obtain the perspective of individuals currently in treatment and their families. And the Bridging the Gaps Implementation Subcommittee wasn't listening to people living recovery. Focus group participants identified a lack of transitional housing and the process to finding an opening difficult. The sad fact is, the county doesn't support abstinence-based halfway houses. Less than a dozen transitional houses for recovery communities, spiritual, secular, and religious, are funded by churches and private benefactors. Many unemployed and homeless citizens who successfully complete a 28-day inpatient treatment program are sent to the county gateway homeless shelters, where a dominant majority of citizens are in active addiction. The Homeless Solutions Gateway policy is unethical, counterintuitive, and a waste of taxpayer money. You don't place someone in the early stages of recovery who's really trying to stay sober back in the crack house to live following successful completion of an inpatient treatment program. These poor citizens have a 3% chance of recovery. We know the acute care model of addiction can safely detoxify and facilitate brief stabilization. Treatment works. But the problem with this model is that it mistakes brief sobriety for sustainable sobriety. In situations where the home environment and social networks are not conducive to recovery, or the client is homeless, abstinence-based intentional recovery communities can elevate long-term recovery outcomes. For example, Philadelphia has 25 publicly funded abstinence-based recovery residences and 250 privately funded recovery homes. Why can't we? President Ronald Reagan signed the Anti-Drug Abuse Act of 1988, which established a nationwide program to encourage the mass replication of recovery houses based on the Oxford House concept. An Oxford House is a democratically run, self-supporting, and drug-free home. The men and women in Oxford Houses pay all the expenses to maintain the individual homes that make up the network of more than 1,500 houses in 46 states. Each house represents a remarkably effective and low-cost method of preventing relapse. Local philanthropic contributions are used to maintain a revolving loan fund that provides startup capital of up to $4,000 for launch of new Oxford Houses. Banks and private benefactors donate properties. Organizations like Habitat for Humanity donate materials and technical resources to help rehab properties. Local governments forgive tax liens on abandoned properties to seed development of recovery houses. Why can't we? The United States Supreme Court on May 15, 1995, issued a decision which confirms that recovering alcoholics and drug addicts living in an intentional recovery community are handicapped and therefore are a protected class within the meaning of the Federal Fair Housing Act, and local jurisdictions must make reasonable accommodation to afford them living arrangements supportive of recovery. A number of subsequent federal cases have affirmed that recovery houses are not commercial institutions and should be treated as single families for purposes of zoning. These juridical decisions have the positive effect of not redlining neighborhoods, nor creating concentrated pockets of poverty in designated areas. Numerous studies show a 50 to 75% greater recovery rate for intentional recovery communities than other forms of treatment. Studies show a return on investment to society ranging from $3 to $7 for every dollar spent on treatment. For abstinence-based recovery houses, the return is $13 to $17 for every dollar spent. Privately funded transitional houses for intentional recovery communities located within Montgomery County, with assertive linkage to local treatment centers, report that during the period 2009 through 2011, the average stay was 9 months, and over 60% of their guests achieved 1 year of abstinence from drugs and alcohol at no direct cost to the taxpayer. People for Recovery are asking local foundations, businesses, churches, individuals, and government agencies to join us in providing technical assistance and establishing loan programs to aid the startup of self-directed recovery homes, spiritual, secular, and religious, without discrimination in our county. With regard to transitioning to aftercare services, residential focus group participants stated that it would ease their transition out of inpatient services if they could attend NA and AA meetings while still in residential treatment. This would help them to establish an aftercare home, as well as help them to learn the culture of the 12-step program. They also identified a lack of sponsors as a barrier to maintaining their sobriety. Numerous studies suggest that long-term recovery success correlates with more intense mutual aid participation. But the Montgomery County Adamus Board has directed treatment agencies to not use 12-step facilitation counseling. As a matter of policy, therapists are directed to not provide assertive linkage to recovery communities. Linking is more than handing a client a piece of paper that lists all the AA meetings in the area. A reality check with the State of Ohio Department of Drug and Alcohol indicates that 12-step abstinence-based recovery education and assertive linkage to recovery communities are allowable expenses. Agencies can also use our local levy dollars for anything they want, including non-medical services. In short, the defunding of 12-step recovery facilitation in Montgomery County treatment facilities is a policy decision made by local county administrators and politicians. The acute care model of addiction treatment is characterized by its crisis-linked point of intervention, brief duration, singular focus on symptom suppression, professionally dominated decision-making process, and increasingly short service relationships defined by cost-cutting insurance companies and shrinking government budgets. Accountability for local treatment programs needs to shift from regulatory compliance, procedural efficiency, and reduction of treatment services to long-term recovery outcomes. In the wake of the bureaucratization of addiction treatment in Montgomery County, the relationships between treatment institutions and indigenous communities of recovery have been weakened. Recall that in Montgomery County, only 20% of crisis care assessments will result in clients completing all treatment sessions, compared to a 41% completion rate for the Great Lakes region as a whole. Without sustained long-term support, over 50% of those people who do complete all treatment sessions will relapse within a year following treatment. To simply reduce access to inpatient treatment, shift emphasis to a methadone maintenance harm reduction model, and extend the case management pipeline 18 months for 95% of people seeking help without fixing the pre-recovery engagement leaks, providing acute care detox services for all people in need, and providing assertive linkage to abstinence-based recovery communities for long-term support is counterintuitive and a waste of taxpayer money. We again stress the issue is not whether we have professionally directed addiction treatment or peer-based recovery support services, but how these and other supports can be best combined and sequenced to enhance long-term recovery outcomes. The shrinking proportion of healthcare resources devoted to addiction treatment and the growing reliance on government funding, 80%, demands effective stewardship of shrinking community resources through a period of sustained economic austerity. People in recovery advocate for building assertive linkage to the volunteer resources of local recovery communities. In the past several years, there's been a push from outside sources to decrease traditional treatment practices that are effective. There is a significant push by Montgomery County administrators for motivational interview training among all treatment and case management providers. The technique was called person-centered therapy by Carl Rogers in the 1960s. Motivational interviewing is a non-directive technique which helps people work things through to come up with their own answers rather than mentoring someone. This non-assertive counseling technique is not the magic bullet that it's being presented as. Our belief is that combinations of treatment techniques serve clients well and vary depending upon the needs of the client. The evidence-based practices most commonly used in residential treatment facilities are 12-step facilitation, cognitive behavioral therapy, and motivational enhancement therapy. The Butler Center for Research commissioned Project Match, a 3-year study comparing these three techniques. The 12-step facilitation approach demonstrated a significantly higher abstinence rate. People for Recovery are advocating that those with addiction have access to the best evidence-based practice 12-step facilitation treatment option used by the abstinence treatment leaders Hazelton, Sierra Tucson, and the Betty Ford Center. There are two fundamentally different ways of knowing: science-grounded professional knowledge and the experiential knowledge of peer-based recovery support groups. Science, in its pride of precision, focuses on the segment, where scientific knowledge places great value on understanding a problem from the outside through the lens of objective distance and carefully controlled experiments. Experience, in its pride of the pragmatic, focuses on what works as a whole. Experiential knowledge seeks to understand a problem from close up and inside, from the subjective experience of those who have lived through and solved the problem. Whereas scientific truth is conveyed in the form of data, experimental truth is truth transmitted by fellowship, support, and the inherited wisdom of those who came before us. In the addictions arena, science and experience meet and at times collide with a third way of knowing drawn from frontline treatment and recovery support services. While science, experience, and clinical practice can occupy common ground, it is in these divergent sources of knowledge that one can find radically different and competing definitions of the truth. For example, such differences in worldviews are evident in the chasm between scientific evidence on the pharmacotherapeutic treatment of opiate addiction with methadone maintenance and attitudes towards these medications expressed within the literature and local group practices of abstinence-based programs. Scientific reviews emphasize that methadone delivered at sustained daily dosages with no requirement to draw down or withdraw result in a reduction of social harm, measured in terms of reduced costs, reduced crime, and reduced threats to public safety and health. These reviews pay little attention to the benchmarks that abstinence-based recovery community members use to evaluate methadone maintenance, such as achieving complete and sustained abstinence, and the quality of one's life and service to others. Recovery community fellowships tend to be highly decentralized in their governance structures and extremely diverse in local group practices. Therefore, any statement attempting to define a recovery fellowship's position on a particular issue is likely to be true in one place, but not in another. What binds such groups and members toward consensus on key issues are the shared understandings of the central mechanism of their recovery program, shared addiction recovery experiences, and the principles that have been defined to guide the personal recovery process and the life of the organization. Abstinence-based recovery programs view addiction as an all-consuming disease with three distinct elements: physical, a compulsion and loss of control over decisions about using; mental, obsession with use; and spiritual, self-centeredness. Abstinence is viewed as the precondition for the pain of living without drugs or anything to replace them that stirs the search for a higher power and fuels the larger process of personal transformation. All recovery programs are distinguished by the belief that the central mechanism of addiction recovery is a process called spiritual awakening. This spiritual transformation, which is generally viewed as a product of working the 12 steps, begins with an admission of the need for complete surrender. We admitted that we were powerless over our addiction, that our lives had become unmanageable. Through this act of submission and the rise of hope, came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity, comes the willingness to do anything to recover, and the acknowledgement that no future alcohol or drug use of any kind is possible if insanity and death are to be avoided. The philosophy of complete abstinence is rooted in the collective experience of its members that all past half measures resulted in pain and tragedy in spite of great and repeated assertions of personal will. Through this lens, any form of drug substitution and any medication used to treat addiction is seen as one more effort at using a material solution, a technological fix, to solve what is at its core a spiritual problem. We emphasize that psychotropic medications such as antidepressants are not seen as drug substitutions, and we support dual diagnosed people in recovery from addictions. Abstinence-based recovery programs are not religious organizations. There is no dogma. The one theological proposition is a power greater than oneself. Even this concept is forced on no one. Somehow, the alcoholic and addict must get enough objectivity about himself or herself to abate fears and collapse false pride. If he or she can do all that through intellect and thereafter willfully support a life structure without transcendent symbol, more power to him or her. We think it no concern of ours what religion or lack of religion our members identify themselves with as individuals. This should be an entirely personal affair, which each one decides for himself or herself in the light of past associations or present choice. Not all of us have joined religious bodies, but most of us do favor such memberships. We need to emphasize with humility that there are more than 60 valid recovery pathways, spiritual, secular, and religious. We do not advocate for exclusion of any option. We advocate for choices. In asserting this position, there is no effort on the part of abstinence-based recovery programs to influence medication-assisted or secular approaches to treatment as a medical or public policy issue. We're only trying to assert and maintain the integrity of our approach to recovery. Any such actions would constitute a violation of traditions. In fact, psychiatrists and physicians helped to bring our 12-step societies into being in the first place and have held up our hands ever since. So let's bring the total resources of our community that can be brought to bear upon this epidemic affecting so many lives within Montgomery County, Ohio. Let us think of unity among all those who work in the field, in the churches, and within abstinence-based fellowships. Let us all stand together in the spirit of service. An ironic fact of recovery fellowships that honor humility and anonymity is that the first person among 20 million people in recovery willing to stand and speak, if that act is any indication, is probably the least qualified to do so. So, recovering people are collaborating with visionary professionals within our community to communicate to the world that addiction recovery is a reality for 20 million people and their families. This movement is calling for a vanguard of recovering people and their families and friends to stand together as living proof of this proposition. We are speaking out against objectifying stereotypes and discriminatory policies that narrow the doorway of entry into recovery.
Hello, my name is Brother Tom Farnsworth. I'm a Marianist brother, a member of the Society of Mary, the province of the United States, and I'm here today to talk to you about the 12-step recovery movement. By training, I'm a clinical psychologist, and I've worked for several years with people with addictions. I found that the 12-step approach has been infinitely helpful for those struggling with substance abuse and dependence.
I am Paul, and I'm a physician in long-term recovery. I am the evidence of things not seen.
I am the evidence of things not seen. I am dual diagnosed and in long-term recovery.
I am the evidence of things not seen. My mom is in long-term recovery, which means that she no longer uses alcohol or drugs.
I am committed to recovery because it has given me and my family new purpose and hope for the future. While helping gain stability in my life, I am now speaking out because long-term recovery has helped me change my life for the better, and I want to make it possible for others to do the same.
People in recovery are asking voters and taxpayers, churches, government officials, treatment providers, and the advocacy community to transform acute care and harm reduction models of care based on the empirical evidence of hundreds of published studies to align with the reality of recovery. Significantly improving long-term recovery outcomes in Montgomery County will require radical re-engineering of addiction treatment as a system of recovery management to achieve long-term recovery outcomes and improve cost-benefit ratios. The stakes are high. The costs resulting from our failed public health care system are mounting for taxpayers and businesses, while Montgomery County citizens continue to die in increasing numbers from this disease. We stress that our abstinence-based recovery option can reduce costs to society and does not add to the tax burden. Mutual aid is the foundation of social welfare in the United States. This is our defining characteristic as Americans, how well we take care of the least among us. To all elected officials and Montgomery County public officials who are seeking data to determine the most cost-effective means to care for the least among us. Approximately 20 million American citizens, who are members of abstinence-based recovery communities, plus our families, church congregations, medical professionals, educators, employers, neighbors, and friends, want you to know that
I am the evidence of things not seen.
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 Do you want to reach out and help others who are still in the throes of active addiction or struggling in their recovery because of discriminatory policies and practices? You can speak out publicly without compromising the principles of the recovery program in which you participate. By doing so, you'll be reaching out to alcoholics, addicts, and their families, providing them with new hope, and educating policymakers. We do not at any time represent a 12-step recovery program. As advocates, we say, I'm a man or woman in long-term recovery, or a family member, or a friend, or an employer of a person in long-term recovery. By signing up with your email address, no names please, your anonymity is respected and guaranteed. Policymakers will only see the aggregate number of subscribers who have signed the People in Recovery petition, and you will receive periodic updates on government and legislative issues that impact the lives of people living in recovery within Montgomery County, Ohio. And you can join over 20 million Americans in recovery from addictions on September 13th at the Ohio State Capitol to meet your elected representatives and demonstrate the power and proof of long-term recovery by bearing witness that I am the evidence of things not seen. Help us eliminate all policies and practices that discriminate against people and their families based solely on their recovery status. People for Recovery receives no government funding. So we're passing the basket and asking you to contribute what you can. The biggest challenge for self-supporting recovery homes are jobs, especially for people facing discrimination in the job market because of their recovery status. We'll send a monthly report disclosing how we invest your money. 100% of your tax-deductible contribution to People for Recovery in care of Dayton Catholic Worker, a member of the Association of Recovery Community Organizations, will fund a Recovery Advocacy Community Technology Center and donations to participating recovery houses for unemployed people new to sobriety who are asking the question, I wonder if I can't get sober by trying to help another person get sober. For the next 12 months, People for Recovery Citizen Advocates will produce and email you a series of common sense, interactive multimedia presentations designed to represent the perspective of people living abstinence-based recovery. We'll also provide political action alerts and easy access to your local, state, and federal elected officials and to the local newspaper letter to the editors to help your voice be heard. This presentation is brought to you by People for Recovery in Montgomery County, Ohio, and is produced by an intentional recovery community of homeless men and women labeled mentally ill. The ideas and opinions presented reflect the views of citizens and do not represent institutional positions. Please add your voice to our petition and email this presentation to 10 members of your circle of friends, and ask each of your friends to email this presentation to 10 of their friends. And please don't break the chain. You're less than 5 degrees of separation from every voter within Montgomery County, Ohio. May God's peace be with your soul.
I am the evidence of things not seen. As a lawful citizen of the United States of America, I hereby petition all elected officials and Montgomery County public officials to eliminate county and state policies that discriminate against and harm people in or seeking abstinence-based recovery.
I ask that adequate funding is provided to treatment centers so that they remain a choice for people who cannot afford treatment or insurance coverage for treatment.
I ask that opiate users be able to choose abstinence-based detox and recovery options.
I ask that treatment centers include 12-step facilitation as one of the several evidence-based practices that agencies choose to use.
I ask federal, state, county, and charitable institutions to form public-private partnerships that help build transitional housing capacity for intentional recovery communities, spiritual, secular, religious. Detox is not recovery.
I ask for assertive linkage to bridge the gaps between intake, treatment, case management, and mental health agencies to recovery community meetings and transitional housing for intentional recovery communities.
I ask for coordination between agencies for client bed-to-bed transfer from treatment to transitional housing and intentional recovery communities.
I ask for an end to the discriminatory Montgomery County, Ohio policy of classifying treatment centers and transitional housing as a residence for homeless people. This policy is forcing homeless people in recovery to live within high-risk gateway shelter populations and putting agencies out of business. Sincerely,